John, very nice to see you again, buddy. You've been a busy boy.
I have. It's good to see you as well, mate. Always good talking with you with regularity.
Yeah, John and myself, for the sake of the viewers, we've known each other online like this for a couple of years now, and John's mm-hmm. intel throughout all of this has been vital. He's often given me good tips and the heads up. And actually, we had a little chat today, and I said, this is quite concerning. John's very good. His inside knowledge about what's going on, not just on worldwide geopolitical events, but actually you've become quite an all-rounder, mate. I have to say, you're doing great.
Thanks. Appreciate it. Thanks for the trust.
John, I asked this favor, again, for the sake of the viewers. I've been doing this quite a long time, and every time we talk about foreign currency, John, I get bombarded with 1,000 questions, and I don't actually have all the answers. I know most of them, but I don't know all of them. So what I wanted to do today was I wanted to have a little chat. We'll go through exactly what we're talking about. When we're talking about the RV, when we're talking about Nisara, Jisara, the reset, all of these points, a lot of people are confused by them. So if you wouldn't mind, mate, if we could go back and just start from the very beginning and just take us on some of these key vital points that people need to know about.
Okay. So you want kind of like a cursory overview of what's going on, the anatomical
approach? I'll give you some questions. So let's just start with, what is the RV? What does the RV stand for?
So it stands for the revaluation of all the global currencies worldwide.
Okay. So why are the currencies worldwide going to revalue?
Because just like here in America, the currencies are artificially suppressed. It's based on a debt system. And, you know, corruption has been, as you know, rampant the world over. These currencies, respectively, around the world and even here in the U.S., are not representative of their true value because it's been debt-based by the central bank system, going all the way back to the Rothschild family, right? Going back to early 1800s, probably even beyond that. But just for modern standards, it's really, you could just go as recently as 1913. When we got put on a Federal Reserve, which isn't part of the federal government. It's just a name only. So you could call it FINO. And they basically, when I say the U.S. deep state combined with the central bank system, which originated in London, as you know, through the Rothschild Bank, basically enslaved the entirety of the world through the U.S. dollar. So we've been, as a country, and when I'm saying governmentally, been enforcing our hand around all these countries around the world, keeping them down. Most notably, countries like we all know about Iraq has been operating on what's called a programmed rate. Programmed rate is an artificial rate. It's supposed to be a temporary rate that is like a tentpole until the real rate is established. The problem is they're so corrupt. They've been doing this for the last 13 years. And now is the ultimate statement is the jig is up. That's now being freed up so that all these countries can truly come into their true value through asset backing. So, for example, you have a country like Iraq, which is rich, we all know, in oil, the fifth largest, second largest oil producer in the world, fifth largest gold reserves in the Middle East. So you have them, they're going to be powering up in gold. And then you have a country like Vietnam, who's going to be powering up in silver, and on it goes, most notably Zimbabwe, which has the most, as you've taught, you know, I've talked about before, the most gold in the world per capita. Second is Uganda. But the world doesn't know that because the mainstream has gone to great lengths and the powers that be to suppress that information. But at some point, which we're now coming into, that's all getting fleeced and opened up. So that's why these countries have been perceived as being impoverished nations when the reality, the actuality is they're quite wealthy. And basically everything that we've learned has been a lie. And now we're having to relearn the truth.
So, yeah, this is very true, guys. For the last few hundred years, the world elite have been controlling this. Some people call them the cabal. There's lots of different words for them. The mafia, organized crime syndicates.
Yep.
But a lot of the political people at the very top have known about this. And what happens is they've been groomed and selected from a very early age. And they actually fund all of their education as well and put them in universities. And if you go back and look at many of the world's top leaders there, such as Rishi Sunak in the UK now, he's been funded by George Soros and the World Economic Forum as well. They've always put their guys in at number one. So this is where it's happening. Over the last, let's just say 300 years, it's been going on for a lot more than that. But since about the 1600s, the top elite and their this gang of organized business people have been deliberately keeping a lot of these countries impoverished, such as the African nations and Asian nations, when they've been creaming it all off for themselves. But John, let's say, for example, we'll talk about Iraq, because if Iraq is about to have some form of stabilization and the currency is going to change, what does that mean for the average guy in the street? Let's say John Wilson living in Idaho. What does it mean to him?
Well, it doesn't mean anything to the average layperson in respect to changing the totality of their lives in the immediate. I mean, if they're holding the currency, it means everything, because it means that the value...
This is what I was going to say. How can somebody, an average Joe in the street, benefit by all of these things that are about to happen?
Well, I think that shows like this can help the totality of that change by getting the using correct discernment, doing your own due diligence and researching and vetting properly for yourself what is, you know, true for you, because, you know, you and my know what we know, but everybody's, you know, reality and truth is variegates from person to person. But for the average person, they can research, use critical thinking, use discernment that God gave you. And if they choose from God telling them that, hey, you should have this currency or that currency or a combination thereof, actually getting in some skin in the game and investing. And once they do, they will realize a tremendous return by having these currency or currencies, because now it's going to go from its program rate to its true value. Iraq, last week and this week, is finishing up a meeting with the World Trade Organization with the agenda of getting on the world trade for the purposes of, you know, revaluing. And you can't join the world trade unless you are going to establish a true value. So they're slowly but surely making their steps to, you know, come back onto the international stage. I mean, this is, we've talked about it before, made often online. This is spiritual warfare, right? It's good versus evil, God versus Satan. So Satan's not going to, they're going to have to relent and surrender, but they're not going to give up without a fight. So as you and I have discussed, this is an East-West reset. The wealth of the West, when I say the West, specifically the U.S. and England, right, the European U.S. nations, is transitioning to the East. And the people that have been persecuted in all these countries are finally, thank goodness, going to be able to get, you know, the bad guys are going to get their comeuppance, and the good people are finally going to be released from all this toxic corruption. For the average person, it means they can get a very substantial amount of resources to do what's on their heart to do, you know, and serve God in the best way they can, whatever he's put on their heart, you know, to do. That's the impact that it would have for the average person.
Yeah, I think that's a very good description. I'm going to add something for that, because what I like to do is I like to give really easy examples. I'll give you a good example of what's been going on. The French have been in control of a country in Africa called Niger. Mm-hmm. And the main commodity that they were extracting, again, John knows about this, we've talked about this, but this is for the sake of the viewer, for you that are watching right now. The French colonial influence and power down there for the last 200 years, probably a bit more, but for the last 50 or 60 years, they've realized that they need one of their precious raw materials, and that's uranium. And what they've been doing is they've been paying the Niger government 50 cents. I have to change the figures because we work in kilos and dollars and everything else, but for layman's terms, they're going to say, we're going to be giving them 50 cents a pound for this precious raw material they use in the production of nuclear power facilities. And it's actually worth about 200 on the open market in its unrefined, get ready for whatever you needed to state. So the French give the locals 50 cents and then they bring it back into the mainline market and they sell it for $200. So that is a phenomenal and immense markup. And they've been doing that for years. But what's happened now is, and this is why people think the country's impoverished, because these people have been keeping these countries in the dark about what their wealth and what the materials and what it's really worth. For example, they always tell a lot of lies saying, oh, it's going to cost us millions of dollars to extract it from the soil. It's a special process. You wouldn't understand it. We've got to bring in the experts. It's the same old spin that they've been putting on in all of these places for many years. So now the government of Niger have realized that, hang on a second, you're buying it from us at 50 cents. You're selling it at $200. No, we can do that. We don't need you anymore. Pack your stuff and get out. So that now means that the GDP of this country is now shot up a huge amount. The general export conditions are the same. They've still got the clients for it. They're just cutting out all of the French middlemen and going straight to market themselves. So that country has immediately become extremely better off because of that one deal. And this is what we're saying. A lot of these countries in Africa, Zimbabwe, all of the countries around there, are extremely wealthy in raw materials, whether it's diamonds or gold or plutonium or oil. Mm-hmm. All of these countries have something. So the average guy in the street in Idaho, that we talked about, it's not going to affect them, but you can get involved in this worldwide change at a very economical rate, because if you acquire some of the currencies that are about to change dramatically, you don't have to spend a lot of money. You can get into it for $20, $50, $100. And this is what we've been doing. We've known about this for quite a while, and this is why we talk about it a lot. And so what we've done is we've acquired some of these countries' currencies, and we're sitting on them waiting for it to revalue. This is what the RV is all about. Is that pretty accurate, John?
Yeah, I'd say that's pretty spot on.
There we go. So if you're sitting in Idaho and you work in a 9-to-5 job, you say, oh my God, that sounds amazing. What can I do? All you're going to do is get hold of some of the currency. If you've got $30, $20, $50, you can buy these notes. But one thing that John didn't want to talk about is how much everybody says, how much is it going to be? We'll just talk about the Iraqi dinar.
When the original invasion? Kuwait,
yeah. Kuwait was invaded. What happened with that currency?
So I had a friend who unfortunately passed away last year to a bad illness. And she expressed to me that her father was invested in the Kuwaiti dinar back in 92, 93, somewhere in that range. And what happened was, is she told me that they put out news in the mainstream globally that the Shah of Iran was killed and that the oil fields were, blown up, and that the country was in ruins, and, you know, that Kuwaiti dinar was never going to be realized. Well, ironically, about a day or two later, the brokers who were representing people who own that currency, like my friend's father, got called and said, hey, it's ready to exchange. So it was a suddenly moment. Now, we know that history repeats itself. So in the interest of historical replication, that's actually a good segue, if you don't mind, for me to talk about some of the notes that I created for today. So just give me a minute. I'm just going to look at some of these here with a fine-tooth comb. Historically, we're going to see that again, and I'm going to explain how in a second. So here's what I wanted to share with you, mate, and your viewers. What the people that I talk to that I have a lot of trust in, I feel good about the discernment of, you know, the knowledge, and you've talked about how you felt it was cogent in the past. What they've shared with me is that coming up somewhere between now and the first of the new year, 24, the BRICS global currency will be the new reserve currency. It will supersede the dollar and the euro. So that has an effect on you, obviously. What most people may not know is that 85% of the globe's population is represented and comprised within the BRICS nations. So what we see happening, when I say we, I mean the people, the collective brain trust of people I talk to with regularity, and kind of what we look at, all the matrix of things, is what we see happening. We see a historical replication with Israel to hit Iran's secret nuclear and oil sites, their private reserves. That's going to be, you know, harkening back to the Kuwaiti situation we just discussed. So there's parallels. Yeah. And we know that the U.S. and Iraq and many other countries, for that matter, copy each other. So we're seeing a delay in the elections in Iraq. We're probably going to see delays in the elections here in the U.S. and probably points around your part of the globe, right? We're seeing a 50% flash crash happening sometime between now and the beginning of the new year. And what we're looking for is XRP to skyrocket in that, because as you may know, mate, you have some of that like I do. And XRP's case is about to be vindicated from the SEC, because the Judge Torres in New York, who ruled against the SEC that proved that XRP is a currency and not a security, has also said, hey, no appeals for you guys. So no givesies, backsies, you're done. You're boxed out. So now what they're trying to do is come up with a settlement. Could be somewhere meagerly between 20 and 30 million, somewhere in that range, which is nothing for compared to what this coin's really going to be worth when it's all said and done, as the head of the blockchain, right? And I'm going to get to that.
Let's come back to that, John. We're veering off. Let's stay on. We'll finish the currencies. Sure. And then sure. I'll put that on the list to go back to because we're
that's
going to
fine.
Confuse people. I wanted to keep this really, really simple and easy for
no,
people to follow.
That's totally fine. Basically, what we see, thank you for that. What we see is it hasn't got, well, there's just a lot of information to try to parse.
I know. Your brain works so fast. I know how it works.
Yeah. It's, you know, I apologize for my shortcomings. It does tend to be frenetic. So thank you for keeping me on point. But we're going to see with Iraq, it hasn't gotten bad enough yet. As Kim Clement said, when things seem at their worst, I will free my people, says the Lord. The good news is we're getting to that climax apex point right now. We're in it. So here's something that will affect the average Joe, which ties back to Iraq. So if you're holding the currency or you're entertaining the notion of holding it, we are going to see the Biden be removed one way or another. The GOP is making concerted effort to impeach him. I think the more likely scenario is the Dems are going to want to have him step down due to an undisclosed medical illness to try to save face, try to create some goodwill. Yeah. You know, people feel sorry for him in some way, which it's a whole other matter. But they're going to rush him to the hospital. And then all of a sudden, a couple days later, oh, he's fine. But unfortunately, he's unfit to continue his duties as president. That's going to erode whatever confidence is left throughout the world with the dollar. And they're going to start dumping, when I say they, I mean European countries, wealthy nations. Yeah. I mean, if you look at China, you look at Japan, you look at all these countries, they're already dumping the U.S. Treasury bonds. They're dumping the dollars. That's what all this is about, is a de-dollarization. So that affects the average Joe in a couple of ways. It doesn't just affect them with the currency, but back to your original point, it affects them with the value of the dollar, right? Because when these dollars come back, it's like the 70s when Nixon took us off the gold standard here in the U.S. It was like a drug. At first, oh, great. You know, my paycheck's double. My house is worth double. It seems good. But then hyperinflation comes in and just wipes that out. Your salaries can never keep up with the cost of the rising hyperinflation when this happens. So it's going to affect the average Joe in a lot of ways, which seem negative in the beginning, but in the end of this whole thing, it ultimately be for their good.
Yeah, you're right about the inflation. If you compare the American dream that was everybody was talking about, what that everybody wants when they get to the States, the 60s and the 70s were the heydays where salaries were high and cost of living was low, gas was cheap, food was cheap. That's out the window now because people all in the 50s who grew up watching and experiencing the American dream, their kids are now trying to find it. And it's extremely difficult with salaries and gasoline and mortgage rates. All of these things are sky high. They're artificially inflated. I mean, you look at some of the neighborhoods that, you know, they're going up 15% a year on some of the real estate. It can't be sustained. You know that. You can feel it in your heart. But don't worry. The Federal Reserve is here to just keep on printing money. And this is where things have gone absolutely, totally loco, because their solution to all of this is we're broke. Oh, let's just print some money. I wish we could all do that. Why don't we do that at home? I'm broke. Let's print some money. It has no real value, the US dollar. This is the long-term problem, is because they know the trillions and trillions of dollars of debt that they've built needs to be solved somewhere. And no disrespect, most of our clients are going to be from the US. The foreign policy that's been on the cabal's agenda, such as invading Afghanistan, Iraq, Libya, now we've got the situation in the Middle East with Gaza. The Americans are sticking their nose in again because it's what they've been doing. The only time we didn't do it was when Trump was here. They stick their nose in, they pick a fight, get into a war. All of the big fellas make money out of it because they're all manufacturing weapons and ammunition. And then after they're blowing the hell out of the place, America gets flooded with immigrants. They all become taxi drivers usually. I've noticed this. I've been going to America 30 years. Every time there's a war, you go back, you get into a taxi. It's some guy that they've just had a war with who's driving the car. Bizarre. So it's got to stop. All of the BRICS nations now. What was the percentage, John, you said? Like 75%?
85% of the global population is comprised of the BRICS.
The BRICS economy, for those that are also going to be confused about that, stands for Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa. But there's been a lot more countries join this new club, and 85% of the world's population are living in these countries. And one of the major things that they're doing is they're saying, listen, we don't want to be tied into doing business with dollars because we know that they're not backed by any form of security. They just keep printing money. It's not like the old days where you could take your dollar bill and say, I want a dollar in silver, I want a dollar in gold, or $10 in gold. That's what they had to do. So they're trying to change all that, and they are changing it. So there's asset-backed currencies. And this is also part of this major play where they're going to revaluate everything.
Right.
So let's talk about some of the other countries that we know are being tagged to also revalue their currencies, John.
Well, I'm glad you said that. Thanks. That's a perfect segue to keep us on task. So we've discussed Iraq. So when I think of this process, I always think of the next man up or the next country up, and that would be Vietnam. Vietnam, just to give a cursory overview for your listeners who don't already know, because I know your listeners are very educated and they're all over the map in their expertise, but they just got to fill in some gaps. So this gives me a chance to kind of do the cursory and then give you a little meat on the bone for this part of it. Okay, so Vietnam is one of those wild card countries that people are now just discovering, you know, slowly the power, because the main focus has been on Iraq. But Vietnam actually, as you know, over the last 13 years, since Iraq really got back in the discussion of RV, and you had Dr. Shabibi, who was pushing for it back then, and there's a whole bunch of political corruption that suppressed that from happening, right? Similarly, Vietnam has been under the auspices of corruption, just like every other country. But what most people don't know about them is that over the last 10 to 13 years, they've had a 34% GDP, gross domestic product, the production of goods and services, extremely. It's the highest of any country in the world year over year concurrently. Well, what people also don't know about them is that they've been on with the World Trade Organization since 2004, but they've been under communism. And so I'll get to that in a minute. So just hold that thought. So they produce a tremendous amount of silver. They have some of the richest Brent crude in their oceans, along with our country, U.S., China was trying to get in there and get at it. And so what Trump and Pompeo wisely did back in 2020 during the, we'll call it the pandemic period, is we created almost a $1 trillion Indo-Asia Pacific initiative, which was designed to help the growth and technological advancements of Vietnam specifically, basically investing heavily in Vietnam, knowing that these resources exist. They have excellent manpower like Japan used to have in the 70s and 80s. Roughly 70% of the manufacturing that was in China from other countries has migrated over to Vietnam. Samsung and a lot of your car parts and chips and all of that stuff has silver in it, by the way. So there's a direct correlation between those two subjects is why I bring it up. So Vietnam is quietly just awaiting to break free. I think they're going to be the next man up because we've seen Ukraine. This is up your alley with geopolitical. We know the Ukraine's already lost. They just haven't admitted it yet. And that's what's going on with Israel. Is I get the question a lot, is Israel slowing down the RV? No, and as a matter of fact, it's helping it because it's the necessary distraction for these currencies to happen. Because look here, while this is happening, right? Left doesn't know what the right's doing.
Yeah.
So now you have Israel, which is ostensibly, as you know, a cleanup operation. It's Ukraine 2.0, pedophilia, sex trafficking, money laundering, etc. The reason I bring that up is because what we're watching for, and President Trump has been saying this repeatedly in many of his speeches around the country, watch for China-Taiwan conflict, which will amass to about a 30-hour event, but they have to create the optics to look a certain way. The significance of the China-Taiwan event is it frees up Vietnam out of communism into the republic that they have, allows Vietnam to power up in silver and back the dong with silver. Now, you and I have discussed this, and for the viewers who don't know, I believe that silver is actually more valuable than gold because it's used for manufacturing, right?
Yeah, you like that one. You like that one. And there's the dong, by the way.
Yeah, there you go. Perfect.
These are the two notes, and we're going to take you through some of the notes and which ones to buy, because there are a few hints and tips that we could do. And this isn't, you know, this is just not us talking. I have all these notes. I've had them for about 4 years.
Yeah.
Long time.
Yeah.
So that makes sense. 10, so I'm with you. So Vietnam, loaded with silver, they need it in the manufacturing industry, especially with electronics. Mm-hmm. And it makes absolute sense why they do that. Now, we know that China has been outpriced the market because these guys in developing nations, such as South Korea and Vietnam, have been dominating this new, they've been very clever with the tax incentives to attract this manufacturing. And as it shows in their GDP, don't just take our word for it. You can go look it up. See how the Vietnam has been climbing steadily over the last 3 years. In fact, I remember something in 2022, it was voted the most, the fastest growing country in Asia, if I remember rightly. Yeah. Some award like that. Zimbabwe.
Yes, sir.
Let's talk about that.
Let's.
Right. Zimbabwe is a different kettle of fish, as they say, because the money from Zimbabwe, it was a bit of an odd story. This, what happened back, remember, Mugabe was the dictator. The economy of Zimbabwe was absolutely spiraling out of control. We're talking $1 trillion, $2 trillion notes just to get a pack of cigarettes or a can of soda. So what happened was they printed in 2008, they printed these series of what are called bond notes, really. And this is $100 trillion. Yeah, Zimbabwe dollars. And then the other one that most people get is the green one, which is 50 trillion Zimbabwe dollars. Now, on this, it does say, I promise to pay the bearer on demand $100 trillion from the Reserve Bank of Zimbabwe. Now, if Zimbabwe is absolutely loaded, it's probably one of the wealthiest countries on the globe, on the planet. When they do eventually cast off their chains of enslavery properly and they get things together, they've already launched their own gold coin, by the way, which is another indication that we're getting close to it. Yep. That note that we're talking about, you imagine you walk in and say, okay, now that your money's worth something, you got to pay me on this. Mm-hmm. So you finish up the rest of that, the little tricks and the story behind
I can actually, because I talk about it so often, you know, that I can actually get it down to brass tacks. Well, I mean, it's just, you know, it's a hot topic conversation. So let's establish, again, the baseline of the Zim, like the other currencies, and then we'll go from there. It's pretty simple. Yeah. Zimbabwe has a combination of Zim dollars that they're using now and bonds that you just showed. What's interesting is I've talked to a couple of friends who have friends there, and what they're reporting is that not in every case, but in many cases, depending on where you are, they don't let the residents, citizens, have the bonds because they were taken out of circulation. Now, hang tight. The Zim is a bond, not a currency. Like you just said, it's a promissory note to pay, not possession. We have a statement. We have a slogan here in America. Possession is 9/10 of the law, right? So whoever's holding it is the owner. So just like other bonds, they're a promissory note that must be paid. Now, if you say, well, they've been taken out of circulation, they must be worthless. But wait. The IMF, the International, I forgot I have to give the breakdown. The International Monetary Fund, which is part of the, you know, Rothschild banking system, along with the BIS, Bank of International Settlements, and the UN and all that stuff. They're all in the same crowd. But even the IMF has recognized between October 18th and 25th of this year, recently, they just came out of Zimbabwe. And there's some articles on one of my channels that talks about it. So I'm not making this stuff up. I have articles to back it up. They have deemed Zimbabwe one of the most valuable up and coming new countries in the world with almost a 4.8% GDP. And it's attributable to the gold mining reserves, which proves they know, and they've always known that they have it. Just didn't want us to know they had it. So here's the wild card. They're having new elections, just like Iraq's about to, just like we're about to, just like you probably will at some point, right? All concurrently throughout the world. There's a gentleman named Nelson Chamisa, who's a Christian. He won, just like he's the President Trump of that nation. He won. They did election interference and snubbed him for this guy, Mangala. However, the citizens really like him, from what I'm reading, and they're making efforts to get him back in and take his rightful place. He has already publicly stated to his citizens, just like Kenya and many other nations, which you've seen before in the past, we are going to a pure gold asset-backed economy and backing our Zim bonds and dollars in gold, which means that these bonds that were out of circulation will now be honored. Okay, so that means they have the gold to back it. Now, people say, well, they're not going to give me all that money in physical currency. Of course not. But I just was telling you that it's going to go digital. So the Zimbabwe bonds are going to go digitally just like all the other currencies. How are they doing that? Because going back to what we were saying, mate, the blockchain system, ISO 20022, which is the digital standard of the blockchain measures that stipulate that banks have to be Basel III and IV compliant. And Basel III means that if you're a Basel III bank, which is every major bank, Wells Fargo, Bank of America, Citibank, Chase, and all your tier two banks, your credit unions, your community banks, that sort of thing. Every bank has to be Basel III. That means that you have to be able to show transparency of how much gold and silver you're carrying your balance sheets. And Basel IV is for only the major tier banks. So the blockchain is going to support, the blockchain is going to be able to support all these currencies going digitally. And XRP is probably the main backer of that. You're muted, mate. You're on mute. There you go.
Yeah, sorry, mate. My phone was ringing. I just had to get rid of it. I forgot to put it on.
No worries.
Okay. Well, yeah, that makes absolute sense. So there's the background history of it. Zimbabwe is one of the wealthiest places. The people in the know have explained this already. But the difference between the Zimbabwe notes is I can't walk in and pay for anything with that right now.
Right.
No. So these have to be exchanged. You have to do a deal. There's a different system for those, which we'll talk about on the next show. But for the time being, we have these notes. The people at the, you know, we're talking Mark Z, we're talking Charlie Ward, we're talking all of the top people that you've been listening to that for advice. We're all holding these notes. Some are holding more than others. We don't really talk about it. We don't sit there and say, hey, how many have you got? It's all about what you're comfortable spending and what you're comfortable purchasing. But it is a good, like John says, it's not really a gamble. But what I don't want to do is to force people into selling other things. Say, look, I've got $500 lying around, or I've got $1,000 there. Let me buy some dong. They'll get a bit of that, and then we'll get a bit of Iraqi dinar, because it's exactly what I've done. I've bought several different currencies, and that's it. I'm happy. I haven't bought any just to look at them. I bought them because I do generally believe that is going to happen. It's the only thing that makes sense to me, John. How are we going to get rid of and tidy up this mess that the world is in right now? It needs this humanitarian funds. It needs people out there. And if you think about it, you get these questions that people say, oh, you can't give all that money to everybody. It's not going to go to everybody. It's a very, very limited number of people actually know about this. I mean, I don't even know what the percentage is, but it can't even be 1% of the population. Not even.
Well, there's two ways to look at it. There's maybe 1% of the population that knows about it, but then that out of that 1%, how many have taken decisive, swift action, and how many people have still held on to it? Because this isn't for the weak of mind. This is for the strong. This is for the long-term people who are really in it for the right reasons and who have faith in God and have faith in his timing and are willing to, because I understand some people, they're in a bad financial situation. They have to sell it off. I get that. But then there are people who just are impatient and not willing to go the distance. But for those who are, out of that percentage is probably I'm estimating 0.1% will actually go the distance and redeem it. Everybody who's held on to and been faithful will absolutely be able to get that. But then there's a question. A lot of people spend their time, mate, focusing on when's it going to happen? How much? I think that's the wrong approach. I think the right approach is, what is my plan when this does happen? What's my, you know, if there's people I want to help in a humanitarian sense, okay. But then what if God says out of the blue, I want you to help these people? You have to have a miscellaneous section, you know, for contingencies that God says, I want you to move here, or I want you to go there, or I want you to help this person or that person. There's always variable change that comes up that you have to account for. And so I would be, if I were people, refining that plan, defining it, revisiting it, because whatever plan you drew up a year ago, 6 months, 2 years, whatever, things change. And you need to be able to be flexible with that, because you've waited a long time, you've paid your dues, you've been faithful, you've prayed, you've studied. There's a lot of good people have done that. Take that extra time you have in the waiting period. God is giving all of his giving people, specifically you and I talk about that all the time, enough time to get in this so that as many as God's people can be blessed by it. In order to do that, you can't just pray or do your diligence. You have to be hashing out subsets of plans of, you know, this is plan A, this is plan B, this is plan C. So whichever way it goes, you are able to move laterally with that. I think that's where a lot of people should invest more of their time.
Absolutely. And I do believe that good things happen to good people. That's one of the strong founders. John, we've run out of time, actually. I like to keep these around 30 to 40 minutes just to keep people there. I know this is going to open up a lot of questions for you folks. So the number one thing we can talk about is where do you get them? And chakraenergy.shop is where we've been working with. They do deliver international. They have their own system to do. We're going to put the links below. You can check out all of the information on there. And if you have more questions about this particular enterprise that you're getting into, we'll be happy to let you send us those questions, because we'll probably do another one of these in the next couple of weeks. Well, John, thank you very much, buddy. This was a really good idea that we came up with. We'll be back in touch in a couple of weeks. John and myself exchange messages on a daily basis if there's something urgent to get it out there. But thanks, buddy. We'll see you very soon.
Thanks, mate. Appreciate your time, mate.
You're very welcome. I've enjoyed that. And again, guys, for any questions or any more information, you can click the link below and you can use the facilities and services of a registered professional currency broker to get your dinar, your dong, and your Zimbabwe and whatever else you fancy. There are some other countries out there that are interesting. Venezuela is one of them. We didn't get a chance to talk about that today, but we will in the future. Thank you very much, John. We'll be back soon. And I hope that gave you some solid foundations and make some decisions that now you can move forward. If it's for you, great. If it's not great, at least you know. Yeah?
Yep. God bless.
Thank you, John. Bye-bye, buddy.